what I think is such unique about the West End is that the history and the ancestry is a long length decades of families who have been established on the West End for years, their own property. It's family oriented. Different families, a variety of families. It's a good question. what I would think that led me down the wrong path is pretty much not knowing and not having a positive role model and going head in into a life without no guidance, and you learn to, over with the experience, you have to learn the right and wrong, which is just poor decision making. But when you know, I think I didn't know how to make good decisions. So therefore, you know, being a young, stubborn, you know, mule headed youth, you're gonna make those decisions it's gonna be detrimental at times to your life. So and it's consequences for those, and sometimes we don't realize until we're stuck in those consequences exactly the effects from our poor decision making. Well, I endured a lot of imprisonment, incarceration. Shielded off from the world, confinement, you know, multiple words, if you want to call them, which pretty much they use to control the individual who's unlawful or unruly, you know, who don't want to abide by the laws, who pretty much don't want to be governed by the laws. So it's criminal behavior, you know. So I do back and trash throwaway clocks and what is nine empire was. Yeah, I probably spent a total of approximately about 10 years, 10, 11 years, something like that.
How was that experience? I wasn't being locked up.
Well, you know, when you you're incarcerated, you're away from your family, you're away from your kids. That experience, you know, at firsthand, you want to adapt. You know, when you're young and when you go through, you make those decisions, and you already got it by just being a person who don't want to listen, who want to indulge in criminal behavior. You're still gonna have that mindset. You know, and it's degrees of strategies that they use to try to break that mentality. You know, so I was one of the ones that, you know, that had to suffer and go through a lot of disciplinary within the prison, you know, because I still didn't want to abide by the rules and laws, which pretty much a lot of us do who make those poor decisions out here in the world. When we go into a prison system, we still had a mindset, and we still stubborn, and we still feel like it's time to toughen up, it's time to turn up, you know, so to speak. So you want to represent your city, you want to represent, you know, who you are. And at that time, you just get even tougher, and you make even more poor decisions until you face with a lot of disciplinary. And the disciplinary can lead to 23-1. You'd be locked for 23 hours. And by standard law, constitutional right, they have to give you an hour out for recreational. And that's pretty much let you out the cell where you can walk or do whatever. So you'd be faced with those type of disciplinary actions. They probably pretty much take a lot of different things away from you. You know, as far as your radio or everything, or any type of thing that they felt was a privilege. So you go to the...
Oh yeah, we rolling, Pop.
Oh, okay. Montgomery wanted to speak to Fred.
Oh, did it? Oh, okay. We'll stop rolling. Let y'all in right quick.
Okay. There you go. Hand it to him.
Okay. Put him on speaker.
That jump set up professional. Put him on
speaker. Yo. What a speaker, Mark.
How you put on speakerphone, Pop? How you put on speakerphone?
He ain't heard you.
How you put it on speakerphone?
Oh,
set the top.
Huh? I think it's Jeff.
Set the top.
Nell. 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 Did I hang up? Nell.
I miss my brother, so these niggas don't remember me. I miss my brother, so these niggas don't remember me.
Me personally, repeat offenders is, I think, is that the lack of knowledge, the lack of resources that's provided in the world, and linking them to those resources, whereas it may be mental health, you know, whereas it may be finances, employment, you know. And then I think that we have to really dig deeper into really what's going on with a person's mind. What traumatic experiences has he really been involved in that prevents him from thinking with a clear head and rationally? So repeat offenders, most likely, if you look deeper into it and assess the individual, is going to be some issues that's going on that may be traumatic from his childhood experiences, you know, from his teenage, or it may even be some in adult stages. And I think that repeat offenders is those that who don't really know how to express themselves, and it's a cry for help. Which one do I guess is this one?
Hey, call. You will not be charged for this call. Whose call is from?
Marzet Toomer.
An inmate at Caswell Correctional Center. This call will be monitored and recorded. For customer assistance, collection, or complaint procedures, or to block future calls, dial 1-866-230-7761. To accept this call, press 5 now. To decline this call,
speaking about the prison system.
Thank you for using Global Tel Link.
Yo.
What's going on?
Hello?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
What's going on with you?
What's up?
Huh?
What is it, Fred?
Yeah.
What's good? Hey, did you check it? You check into that?
Yeah, I'm still waiting on the response back.
Okay, okay. What's good, though? LP come through?
Yeah, he said he's gonna get with me this week. This weekend.
Okay.
Yeah, this weekend. Yeah, he gonna get with me this weekend and see what I can do as far as getting that to you. Yeah, I was just in the middle of some footage and was talking about the prison system. Man, what can you share with us about? I was talking about the prison system. What is by you being in the prison right now on this phone call? What can you tell? You know, give us some insight about the prisons. You know, as far as you know, the conditions and what go on in there, as far as something that you don't like, that you wish you could change, or a message that you can get to the people out here who, you know, to prevent them from coming, being in that situation.
Well, based on, you know what I'm saying, my experience in and out, you know what I'm saying, if I would have stuck with my job that I had out there, and if I was put more into being a productive person, you know what I'm saying, I would never came this way. You know, I was lured to the activities that was in the community because it wasn't too much going on in the rec center no more. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't that beneficial as life. You know, we can go down there and learn some to better help ourselves. But baseball games on down in Line Park no more. Was no football activity.
Okay.
You remember, we had the little gym where we had the basketball in there. That was somehow taken away from us. So, the only thing we had to look for was being in the street, you know what I'm saying? Because that's the only thing that was going on as a youth growing up.
Yeah.
And as I see them, what y'all doing, y'all give back to the community, and have a stuff at the park. You know, that's getting kids more of an insight that, you know what I'm saying, there's something better that I can do with my life. Just hang on the corner, drink a beer, or a joint or something like that right there, they can do something more productive.
Okay. So how much time do you actually got?
I got 2 7 years and 4 months.
You said 7 years and 4 months?
Right, while.
2 7 years.
7 years, 4 months, and another 7 years, 4 months, boxcar.
Oh, boxcar. So you got a total of about 14 years.
Yeah, well, 14 years and 8 months.
Okay. And you fighting right now, just, you know, just a lot of laws coming through, and you know, it's a possibility that, you know.
Pick up a little bit, because the fans are loud in
here. Oh, okay. All right, well, look, hit me back in a little bit, and, but yeah, that's going to happen this weekend.
Okay.
All
right.
All
right.
Okay, stay up.
Huh?
I said stay up.
Okay, you too,
bro. All right. Come on. Ah, man. See, whew, 14 years. But yeah, like I was saying, the lack of resources. You know, I was just speaking on that, lack of resources. So, you know, that's mainly what we want to do and what we created. Individuals, you know, more things to do, pro-social activities, you know, introduce them a lot to interpersonal skills so they can develop social skills to know how to interact with individuals in a positive manner, regardless of how you feeling, and you know, for that day, you know, kind of, you pretty much stay positive. You know, that's our whole thing and our whole movement, and helping them understand and create strategies and techniques, you know, that can improve, to help them to stay focused and also improve academics and education, you know, so they can be successful in employment and so on, and connecting them with that job training skills. So it's a whole bunch of things on the table that we want to do to prevent mass incarceration rate. Oh man, 5-10 years. Woo! I learned to be able to make righteous decisions, you know, rationalize my thinking, so that, you know, my actions don't lead, you know, to put me in a predicament to that I am incarcerated, you know, and also learn to be able to, you know, I developed a lot of experience, training, certificates, a lot of knowledge, job opportunities that continue to move forward and open up a lot of doors. So my thing is, and I constantly stay and improve myself, like I say, socially. So everything that I'm gonna produce or bring to the table with the with each program that we create is what has helped me as an individual to be able to adjust to society. So therefore I want to give back to help others be able to, you know, learn some of those skill sets that can help them be successful in life. You know, so my mindset right now and my focus is just achieving the next goal, and learning patience. We wouldn't be here if you were just like me. Bad guy, good. Poor parenting. You know, the lack of parenting skills and no good positive role models. So therefore you have kids that's taking it to the brotherhood or looking for support outside of home. And you have these individuals who introduce them to a brotherhood that they can feel comfortable with, and they can trust in, and they feel that's loyal, you know. And some of them can't survive, can't feed themselves. The parents are using drugs. If the parents not using drugs, then you got some of the parents that's, you know, just not paying attention and getting involved in other things, relationships, and just neglecting. So yeah, it's a cry for help. So you have these other individuals, you know, become vulnerable to anything outside the home. So you have individuals that, you know, just become getting into a part of something, you know, for that particular reason, you know, just needing support. And you have people that's going to offer support to be in some type of brotherhood, because everybody want to feel like they have friends and being accepted. I have somebody who's going to ride with them regardless, and not look at them in a way, or look down upon them, you know, so be looked at as someone or equally. Is that right? No. Should they, you know, connect with other individuals that have their best interest? Yes. But are there any, you know, and if they are, how do you connect with them? So you got to put a lot of positive role models in place. You know, it's a lot of people that I want to see step up and become positive role models, you know. So therefore, you know, everybody that's, you know, involved in gangs or gang leadership is not a positive role model. It should be, you know what I'm saying? I've seen some and I see a lot that I think may be handled in a different way. You know, and that's power, and that's leadership. I think that leadership, what I would like to see is a lot of people, you know, utilize that that leadership role in a positive light that can actually save lives. You know, but you got some individuals who became a part of that for those particular reasons, for type of support. So then when they get a certain type of rank, it's no knowledge that's being, and no one's being educated. So then you have no one at the top to be able to educate youth, to take them into a direction that can help them grow individually so they can be successful. You know, I just don't see nowhere going with it as growth. And when I talk about destructive behaviors and leading to a mass, or contributing to the mass incarceration rate, you look at those individuals going that way because it's laws that's created for those individuals going that way. And I think by having the right leadership, by having the right influence, they should be educating individuals that this is the direction that they're trying to get us to go in. So therefore, you produce great fruit. You try to introduce them and educate them to being successful. Therefore, you know, you can benefit as a whole, you know, instead of in a negative way. So I think that, you know, if that was to happen, you know, I wouldn't pretty much disagree with it. But I until I see, you know, somebody stepping to the forefront and showing some leadership, I see a lot of people with leadership qualities to be able to do that. And that's the next step. I see a lot of individuals like, for instance, combining, you know, with the disagreement of the rival gangs and some of them coming together, you know, to be able to do exactly what I'm saying. You know, so it's a start. You know, I do see it growing. And, you know, shout out to all those who are taking that, their leadership and using it in a positive light to be able to impact lives, because that's what we need. We need more of that, you know. You know, for the record, I ain't affiliated, you know. But I know a lot of youngsters, you know.
Yeah. And that's actually my question. You said that's my question. You were once a youth, and even after you got older, you went through the prison system.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's my understanding that gang culture is heavy in prison.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it that, or did you ever feel pressure to join one of these gang organizations?
Nah. Pretty much because the type of individual that I am, I always been a leader. You know, I always and pretty much stood on my own. So I can never see myself getting involved in something for the reason of needing to link up with anybody. You know, at times I've been a one-man army. So, you know, I think about destruction. I think about just destroying it myself. So, I had no, you know, no intentions of, you know, ever being able to link with individuals, but always had a mutual respect with individuals who I had a connection with, and we did develop some type of brotherhood or friendship, you know, and that's how, that's the difference from now, these days, and when I was young.
So when you developed them friendships, did anybody ever try to talk you into getting involved with their gang, or?
Nah, because I think it was just a respect level. You know, I think back in them days, it was just respect. You know, I think back then, and everybody probably thought I was, you know, too even crazy to even, you know, even rock with no gang getting away. But, you know, so much of a live wire. So, individuals that seen me and respect me, it was just some mutual respect that we had. And, you know, Fred, to stay out of your way, you stay out of his. You know, if it come to some conflict, we come to a head, you know, it's going to get resolved. And, you know, I'm going to be on a million, you know. So, like I said, it's develop a certain particular respect. I never had an individual even try to, you know, approach me. I think it's just individuals, people just know how you are as an individual, you know, how you rocking, you know, so different era, you know. I just think people just look at me, it'd probably be like, you know, and I was in different geographical locations. So, but I think people be, from what I've seen in my experience, people connect and become a part of a gang willingly, or want to know, a curiosity about what they hear about the gang. And I never had the insight, the curiosity to want to be a part of something. I always thought I was that person. So I always had a leadership mentality, or, you know, that Fred is going to create what Fred is going to create. And I think that everybody should have that type of mindset. You know, you should be, you can, you know, be your own person. You don't need a group of people, you know, gathering. And I know that some people need to be able to link with certain individuals, or some people, and that's just you as an individual. But I never had the need for anybody, and I think that's just from where I was raised.
I guess my question is, do people feel this is, I guess, do people really feel like you've changed?
I think people know I changed. If not, the crime rate would be high than it is right now. You know, so, and it'd be a new world order if I hadn't changed. You know, but you definitely can see it, whether, whether I'm slow to anger now, my attitude and my outlook on life. You definitely, if you know me, you know there's definitely been a big change. You know, so from the outside looking in, there's been a lot of teeth knocked out, if I want. So, you know, my name be ringing. So, you know, I'm pretty sure that, you know, Durham PD is aware, you know, of the change, because my name's not circulating. Yeah, I enjoyed it at first. You know, when you're consuming a lot of substances, you know, drinking, you're smoking, you know, it's just, every day's a holiday. Yeah, it's fun at first, you know, but when you start to, when your friends and relatives start losing their life, you know, when money becomes short, you know, you can't use your substances that's usually contributing to your happiness that you done became dependent on, is when it's a drought, or you don't have the money slow from doing that, then it's not, you know, it's not a fun game, man. It's not fun, you know. It become very difficult, you know. So for me, it was a constant uphill battle because of the money spent with attorneys. The money spent always fighting the case. You know, it was a constant case, and I was constantly downtown, Durham, in a jail cell, you know, putting up a bond. You know, so then the money I make then is going for a bond, and only those bills and the bond back and forth. So it's and then it becomes stressful. Then it's, you know, it ain't as fun no more, because I'm not more winning. I'm even out. Then eventually it's like I'm losing. You know, and that's with, you know, everything in life, you know, like I said, from, you know, from the rent being due, from the lack of drought of substances becoming into the city, you know, from the police beefing up, you know, we're against them, you know, they trying to lock me up, I'm trying to beat them, you know, it becomes a chess match. So you endure a lot of stress. You know, you have to look over your back about the police, then you have to, you know, you have to worry about people, you know, you had a problem with, you know, so then those issues, then I got to keep these guns, I got to keep me a certain amount of clips on me, you know, then the police, and then, so, you know, it's a lot, it's a lot, it was a lot of sleepless nights, wear and tear on you. There's always another route, you know. There's always multiple choices, multiple options, you know. It might not be a lot of them, and that's what we're trying to do now, is to create people with multiple options, so alternatives, so that, you know, when your mind is made up or you get tired of doing this and tired of contributing to crime, then you have multiple options. You never have to do anything, of course. You always have an option. I could have been more patient, kept playing in sports and did something different, but my mindset, I wanted to get into, try to survive faster, get the easy money. It was so accessible then, you know. It was the 80s, you know, the crack it hit, you know, Lucini falling from the sky. So, you know, those type things that kind of intrigue you and persuade you into that way, you know. Just that's how evil spirits do. We don't get into that spirituality, but it's always, you always have a choice. It's always a alternative. It might not be many. So I think I chose to do that. And will I change or does it, to answer another question, I wouldn't really change. I'm, you know, glad I'm thankful for what I went through, because a lot of times I feel like I'm the sacrificial lamb that, you know, my life experience sometimes have to be a model of, you know, what you do or the cause and effect of what you do or what you don't do, what can happen. And, you know, God don't make no mistakes. I think, you know, he brought me through that, so I can't be the person I am today. And if everybody can't go through what I went through, everybody can't transition how I transitioned and be able to do it at a certain rate. So God, he does, he puts you on a path for certain. He don't put more on you than you can bear. So that this path was created for me. It was written. I had to go through it, and therefore it made me stronger, made me wiser, and it helps me to be able to impact others, because I can explain it and impact others. So, you know, also with my negative influence, my life, I had to be, you know, the one that's taking this walk, and it's others that, you know, that's chosen to take this walk too. You know, once they get inside or get in touch with that particular individual or turn in their life with those same leadership abilities, they're gonna walk and a lot of doors gonna open up, and it's gonna be a lot of other testimonies as well in Durham. It's a lot of them. So but you have to cross that threshold and know that this is what you want and continue to move forward. Not the straddle of the fence. Once you know you're done with that life, you're done with that life. I mean, you can't fool God. All knowing, omnipresent. Huh?
You might be a little off base. How was it being locked up with Tim McVeigh? And actually being locked up when he was executed.
Oh, man.
What was that experience like? First, tell me, how was locked up there with him, and then how was it that day he was executed? Because you was in there.
Yeah, I was there. Pretty much, it was crazy, because that was another one of the signs. See, that's why I was gradual, like I was saying, I was working. I was put right in a unit that was facing death row in Terra Haute, Indiana. My unit in my room, I literally can open the door. What up, death row? What up, fool? And they were right, you know, some yards away, but they were separate from anybody else. They unit, you couldn't, but, you know, it was some yard space that separated. It was like a different building, but it was connected to the building. But you could, it wasn't 100 feet to the building, you know, so you can open the window and talk to them. Timothy McVeigh, like, dudes would be in there, you know. Tim wouldn't even talk. Like, Tim didn't even talk to too many people. He was isolated in there, and I don't know why he done what he done, but like he never, I heard a lot of guys over there in death row that still had or conversate or get into debates, like Carolina Duke debates, and, you know, still would carry on about life knowing they're gonna pass and they're gonna die soon, executed. you know, like I think it was one of Larry Hoover partners, Hitman, was over there on death row. Pretty much a lot of people just pretty much lived their life regularly. Timothy McVeigh was quiet in this room. I hear him like, Tim, what's up? You ain't saying nothing. F you, dude. You know, they'd be like, Tim, what up? Like, hey, shut up. You know, like he just was a type of person that did those bombings like that. You would think that he was just really like a vigilante, but Timothy was very quiet. And they however Tim took that fall, or maybe it might have been altered, you know, some of these groups are, you know, have somebody to go down or manipulate them to do some wrong, and they're not built for it. You know, a lot of groups do that. People do charges or create charges, and then they can't get out of it, and they really wasn't built for that. Tim wasn't built for that. But they locked the whole prison down. Executed, you know, people was on the fence, you know, picketing and wanting to make sure they seen them burn, you know. But yeah, they shut down the whole prison. We was pretty much in our cells like 24 hours, you know. We weren't 23 and 1. You weren't even coming out, you know, whenever they do an execution. So to experience an execution in the same prison that you in, and this was my first time ever being locked up, and I'm way out here in Indiana, and, you know, in a death row camp, you know, in a death row facility, the only facility that does death row or execute people in the federal system, was definitely an eye-opener, you know. And another sign, I said, how is it that I'm right here in this penitentiary right here by death row, and is right outside the window? We want to empower individuals to make the righteous decisions and tackle issues, educational employment that can affect their personal growth. We want to enhance motivation for positive change. And that's what we'll continue to do.